Here it comes again. My clothes too big for me. They said they ain't got no cure.
I was watching Guy Tat's video on freedom, and I liked everything that he had to say, that freedom is a state. It's a state of mind. It's a state of heart, and then reflected in our outward reality. And I thought a lot about what it means to be a slave, because I think he had some really great thoughts on that as well. And I wanted to put this video together and talk a little bit about some things that I learned about slavery and about freedom. Working in a project that I did in 1999 and 2000. And many of my YouTube viewers know that I'm also the founder of a nonprofit, faith-based nonprofit organization called The Reckoning International. And this is a little bit of a story of how The Reckoning started as well. And it's got a cool connection to knives. And so I want to take you through that story a little bit. So back in the mid-90s, I was working in the little country of Nepal, which is right between India and China. And Nepal is home to some of the highest mountains in the world, the Himalayas, and of course the most famous being Mount Everest, which is the tallest mountain in the world. And I was working in the southern part of the country. I was working with a people group from Nepal called the Taru people. They're one of the oldest indigenous people groups in Nepal and very oppressed. My Nepali partner told me that about 140,000 of them were involved in a slavery system called the Kamaya system at the time. Pretty amazing to me, because I thought that slavery had gone away with the Civil War or something like that. Well, the shocking thing that I found out is there are more slaves today than any other time in history, and it's a big problem in the world. And I just knew, hey, we had to do something about this. Well, I found out from my Nepali friends that these Taru people who were involved in this slavery system, it's called the Kamaya system in Nepal, that many of them had been slaves for three or four generations, and that on the Taru New Year, there's a day called Magi, and it's kind of, I guess, like their New Year's Day. And Magi compares kind of to the Day of Atonement in the Old Testament, in that it was a day when, or it's a day when you can redeem people out of slavery. And so we began thinking about this, and we wanted to do a redemption project. And we began to explore this idea and talk to some people about redeeming a group of people out of slavery, about just, you know, buying some of these Tarus and setting them free. And so we decided to do a small project because, you know, working with people who've been slaves for three or four generations, it's not just a matter of kind of buying them out of slavery and setting them free. Because if you've been a slave for that long, you're not just a slave to a master externally, but you're a slave in your own mind. So maybe the best way to say it is that you can get people out of slavery, but it's tough to get the slavery out of people. And so we couldn't just redeem them and not take care of them in some way. And we also knew that we couldn't take care of them in a way where they became dependent on us and just sort of switched masters. So we talked a lot about this with our Nepali team members, and my partner over there, his name is Gopal, he'd actually come up with the idea. And so we began to think this through, and we decided to start raising some money to do a project, not just to redeem people, but also to do some development work with them, to say, hey, how can we get them working? How can we get them being self-supporting and not dependent on the care of other people? And so began to think and pray and plan and raise some money. And at the time, I hadn't really even formed my organization, which is called The Reckoning International, but I'm just kind of in the early stages of trying to do some development work. And so we began to talk to some of our friends and, you know, to get some donations to raise the funds that were needed. And I didn't have a lot of people to go to at the time. I didn't have a lot of relationships built yet for that kind of work. And so I got the idea. I'd been a knife maker for a little while. And I got the idea that I should make some knives and sell them and use the money to do these development projects. So I was talking one day to a friend of mine, and he's the owner of Weaver Leather, or at the time, he's since sold the business, but he was the sole owner of Weaver Leather, Paul Weaver. And I began to tell Paul about these people who were in slavery, and he just couldn't believe it, because like I did, he just thought, you know, slavery doesn't exist in the world anymore. And so Paul is an outdoorsman and loves knives, and he's bought some of my knives in the past. And he told me, he said, "Tim, I'd really like to help, and I tell you what, I want you to make two really special knives for me." And he stopped by one time and he showed me, he had these really unique old case knives. And what they were was, they were, I wish I had a picture to show you, but it was a case knife that was a hatchet and a knife, and the hatchet blade, excuse me, and the knife blade interchanged into the handle and fit in a sheath. And he had a friend of his who collects them and is one of his hunting buddies, and so he said, "Tim, do you think you can make something like this?" And I said, "Well, I think so. You know, I could just try." And so I looked him over. He left it with me, and I checked him out, and first thing I saw right away was how casework, their locking mechanism, wasn't very sturdy. And so what I asked him is, I said, "Hey, Paul, I'd like to make these knives for you, but I'd like to do kind of my own version. Like, I'd like to think up a way to do it that has a different locking system and make kind of my own shape or design of the knife." And so he said that would be fine. And he told me, he said, "Look, if you make two of these for me, make them really nice." And we agreed that he'd pay $1,000 a piece for these. And so I started working on this knife and just drawing on paper and thinking about how I would do it. And so I made them out of ATS-34 stainless steel and titanium liners that are really thick. And I made kind of like a liner lock is how I designed it. And instead of a stop pin, I have a real solid piece of heat-treated ATS-34 inside of the knife. You'll be able to see in the pictures that kind of stops the hatchet and the knife blade, and it really locks up tight because I left the liners very thick. They're about 100 thousandths of an inch thick, and I didn't mill any relief into the liner, so it's really tough and safe that way. And so I'll show you here what I came up with. And then when Paul purchased those knives for me, I actually made three of them because I knew they were complicated enough where I thought I may not ever make another one. And I thought it'd be nice to make him two and make one that I can keep for myself. And so the one I kept for myself is the one that I'm going to show you and kind of take a look at how it works. So that's what the knife and hatchet combo looks like. All of the steel is ATS-34 and 3/16 of an inch thick, so it's pretty beefy. You can see here are a view of the titanium liners. They're about 100 thousandths of an inch. And then that's the hardened back spacer. It's ATS-34 and heat treated just to make it really strong. So here's a little video about how this works. You can see here green canvas micarta that's been bead blasted, and it's screwed on to the scales with screws. And then that's the liner right there that's split like a liner lock. And you push it over, it's very stiff. Tilt the blade down. And when you pull it back like that, that little hook in the back just unhooks, and then you have the handle section like that. It pivots on a 3/16 of an inch hardened dowel pin. And then you just push down, click up, and it locks into place just like that. So pretty cool. But that's, you know, just very simply how it works. The lockup is super positive. There's no play or slop in the blade at all. And it's nice and sturdy little combination there. So after we'd raised some money, what we did is we went and talked to some of these Taru Kamayas and just told them that we wanted to redeem them, that we wanted to help them to get out of slavery and to start working and being self-supporting. And initially we decided to do a small group of people just because the responsibility is so great to take care of people. And so we decided that we were going to redeem 15 people out of slavery. And here's what's really interesting. We talked to a number, our Nepali team talked to a number of these Kamayas. And on Magi, we went to redeem them. And we'd actually talked to more than 15 people. And some of the people that we wanted to redeem, when we sent our team to their master's house, they weren't there. And we weren't sure what happened to them. We weren't sure if maybe their masters had had a change of heart and had them tied up in the jungle somewhere or something like that. But anyway, we redeemed 15 people, and it was amazing. We bought human beings like you would buy a dog at the dog pound. And people ask me a lot of times, what did you pay? Well, the cheapest person that we redeemed, well, let me start with the most expensive. We redeemed a couple out of slavery, and we bought them for about $400. And then the cheapest person that we redeemed out of slavery, we bought a 65-year-old man for $8. And just, I mean, it's hard to even say that, you know, you could go into a Starbucks and spend more than $8 easily on getting some coffees and stuff like that. And we redeemed this man out of slavery. He had been a slave for 3 generations. And he could only count to 5. He had just worked all of his life like an animal in the fields. And so when we redeemed these people, we told them, said, hey, look, there's no strings attached. You're free to go. If you have somewhere to go, go. And, you know, God bless you. And so 3 of those 15, you know, shook our hands and said, hey, this is the nicest thing anyone's ever done for us, and they left. And there were 12 of them left over who said, we have nowhere to go. And so we said, hey, we'd like to help you. And we bought some small pieces of land that were just under the average size of a villager in that area where they could support their families. And we told them, we said, look, your sweat is our money. If you live on this land for 1 year, and you don't leave, and you get a harvest, we'll deed this land over to you. Which to them was unbelievable, because again, they were many of them the only person in their family to be free in 3 or 4 generations, and certainly the only people in their family in that long to own a piece of land. So it was really, really amazing, and too long of a story to tell the whole thing, but that's also how my organization got started. It had such an impact on me personally that I said, hey, I've got to formalize the system a little bit. And so that's how the Reckoning International got started. And so I used money from knives that I made to, and also from donors that, you know, people gave us very generously, gave us money, and we bought them out of slavery. And so it's kind of amazing that knives can change the world. Well, after we did that first redemption project, a couple days later, we saw some of the people that we wanted to redeem out working in their master's fields. And so our team went and talked to them and said, hey, what in the world? We came to redeem you. You know, we came on Magi to buy you from your master. And you know, did your master hide you, tie you up in the jungle or something like that? And they hung their heads, and this is what they said. They said, no, I was scared. I've been a slave so long that I didn't know what would happen to me if I was free. And at least as a slave, I have something to eat. And I don't know how to be free. And I'll tell you what, that was one of the most heartbreaking things that I've ever heard in my life. And amazing to see these, you know, some of the poorest people in the world who I've just been slaves so long that it's hard to be free. So when Guy Tat says that slavery freedom is a mentality and that slavery is as well. He's absolutely right, because I saw it right there. So here are some of our Taru friends that we redeemed out of the Kamaya system. And these guys and their wives and a couple kids made up the group of 12 people who stuck with us, and we helped them with development projects. Pretty creepy document. This is printed on rice paper and has those fingerprints on there, but this is actually a bill of sale for Kamayas to us. And because they couldn't read, most of them are preliterate, they put their thumbprints on here for signatures. And so this is one of the deeds to people that we redeemed. You can just get a little bit of a look at it here, what it looks like. And man, it's just hard to believe that this is how things were there and are in many places in the world. So last year I went to Nepal again. I used to go every year, and then there was some violence in the country, and that's kind of died down now, so I've been able to go back, and we'll go again this year. But here are two of my friends that were in that black and white picture that you saw. Their names are Umesh and Rajesh, and they're amazing guys, and it's just so fun to see them living in freedom and prospering. Umesh and Rajesh, they didn't need handouts. They needed a hand up. And like a lot of the poor in the world, they're just looking for an opportunity. If you give handouts, it helps for a while, but it can actually make them slaves again and dependent on us. So the reckoning, what we try to do is make livelihood solutions that are sustainable, to get people working, to get people using their own talents and gifts that God has given them to work, make a living, support their family, and be generous to others. And that's the story of redemption. So I think that Easter and Passover are dynamically linked. Passover is a celebration of people coming out of slavery in Egypt, who've been slaves for generations, being set free and brought into their own land and learning to be free, connected with that land. And I think freedom is something so precious, and freedom all over the world is needed by people. There's about half the world's population right now, maybe not quite half, but about half of the world's population lives on less than $2 a day. They're in really desperate poverty, and they may as well be in slavery economically, because all of their efforts go into just simply trying to live. And that's why I'm such a big proponent of development. I'm such a big proponent of training the poor, working with them to understand how to work, how to prosper, and how to make it on their own. And I, like Kylie says, not just to survive, but to thrive. And so that's been fun to see in Asia, in Africa, and Latin America and other places where I've worked with The Reckoning. You know, it's really interesting, too, that with the people we redeemed out of slavery, they ask us this question. They said, why are you doing this? We don't know you. Why did you buy us? Why did you redeem us and set us free? And it's interesting, the word redemption, you know, as a person of faith, as a Christian, the word redemption is pretty powerful to me. And that word redeemed in Greek is ex agorazo. And ex agorazo is, you know, what we translate as redeemed means to be bought out of the slave market and to be set free, never to be a slave again. And so we're trying to think of a simple way to explain this to people that had just found their freedom. And we said, well, you know, we serve a God who historically, all through the history of the world, has hated slavery. And we were slaves too. We weren't slaves to an earthly master like you were, but we were slaves to darkness, and someone came and redeemed us, paid a debt that we could never pay on our own. But he didn't redeem us with silver and gold. He redeemed us with his precious blood, and he's our Passover lamb. His blood was shed that death might pass over us, and they understood that. It was really fun and pretty powerful. So happy Easter, happy Passover to all of you my friends, and we really need to treasure freedom. Freedom is not free. It's been paid for by a great price, both in our country and around the world. And there's still people every day trying to pay that price, and it costs them even their blood to try to find freedom and to live free. And like Guy Tat said in his video, I also believe that we can be slaves to materialism. And if you're a slave to money and to your possessions, it's just like being in jail. I mean, your bars in that prison cell may be made out of gold, but they're still bars, especially if they keep us from some of the things that are most important in our lives, like our family and friends and other things like that. So thanks so much for watching. It's been fun to tell you this little knife story. And again, happy Easter, happy Passover to all of you.
Here it comes again. My clothes too big for me. They said they ain't got no cure.